Hello, I'm Dr. Ron Eaglin, and what we're going to talk about today is getting started in Visual Studio 2012 doing web applications. I've got Visual Studio 2012 up here on the screen. I have already done the installation, which is not a trivial installation. It's relatively involved. However, have it up and running. I use the Visual Studio C#. That's a language I'm going to use in the courses that I teach. So that is my also default language that's going to be there. So I'm going to start right off the bat with starting a new project. And what we're going to do today is we're going to look at doing a web forms application. I will, in other lectures, take you through different types of applications, but this is all about web forms applications. So when you open up Visual Studio and you say new project, you're going to see that you have a number of installed templates here. And one of the installed templates underneath Visual C#, and it will say Visual C# right here, if that's your default language, is the ASP.NET web forms applications. As you can see, there's a lot of other different types of forms, types of applications that you can do here, all using C# as a primary language. I'm going to change the default name to Sample Application 2. We're actually going to call it Sample Application COP4834 because I'm going to be using it in that course. And this is the first one that I'm going to actually do here. It's going to create this into Visual Studio 2012 projects. I'm going to create a directory for that. I don't have source control installed on this current machine, so pretty much using the defaults. I hit OK, and now it's going to start working on creating that project called Sample Application COP4834. What it's going to give you when it's done with this is an actually working application that can be run. It does take a few minutes to go ahead and create it, and if you look down here, which you can see down at the bottom, it's doing a lot of different things. Once it's done, you should be able to see a screen with the inside of the Visual Studio, with the Visual Studio menu, which, by the way, we're also going to look at in a lot of detail, a Solution Explorer, which is this window right here, the default page, which is right here, and then the properties, which are right here. What I'm going to do right off the bat is I'm going to go ahead and click this, and I'm going to run this application inside of Firefox. It's actually created a default application for you, and we're going to start looking at how the pieces fit together. By the time we're done with this full series of lectures, which I don't know how many it's going to go into, you're going to understand every aspect of how this sample application works. So if I go ahead and click this, it's going to go ahead and bring it up. I'm going to pull Firefox over here. It's connecting to it in the local host. And this is what the sample web application, web forms application looks like. It has your logo here, a set of menus here, register and login. By the way, these register and login actually do go to pages. So if I click on each of those, there are pages in the project itself. So a register, a login, all those pages do exist. However, they don't really do anything in particular. They're things that you're going to change to customize for yourself. So let's back out of this. Let's go ahead and go over here. But I do want you to take a look. See, the page is created. And we're going to look at this page. So I'm going to leave it up and running. But I'm going to click this stop debugging here, and I'm going to go out of the debugging, and we're going to start looking in a little bit of detail at this page. Now, the page you just saw in here is default.aspx. So over here in our architecture here, the page that we're looking at is the code for default.aspx. Now, if I look at this page, I can come down here and I can note that I have three different ways to look at this: design, split, and source. This is the actual HTML-based source code for the page that you saw there. If I go into design mode, I can actually look at it in design mode. And if you notice, it actually said loading the master page. We're going to talk a little bit about that too, but I'm going to do that from the source code view. So if I look at the source code, the first thing I have right here at the very top is this with a less than, percent, and an at symbol, and those are called directives. Okay, directives are always at the top of an individual page, and they are exactly what they say they are. The directives for it, there are directives specifically for that page. So this one, because it is got the page next, is called the page directive. The page directive has a number of attributes. The attributes that you see here are title, language, master page file, auto event writer up, code behind it inherits. So those are the attributes of that specific page directive, and you will need to know how to work with these attributes for multiple types of directives. One of the most important ones you're going to deal with is going to be the page directive. In this case, the page title is one we're going to look at specifically, but the language is important too. We're going to be using C#. Before I move forward, though, I'm going to look at a little bit at this master page file where you see the tilde slash site.master. Tilde slash means go to the root directory and look for the site.master. If I come over here to the Solution Explorer, I can see that I actually have a page called right here site.master, and I'm going to go ahead and open that. So here is site.master. And if you notice, it looks like also like an HTML file, and it also has a page a directive, which is the master directive. Also has a language and some other attributes that go with this. Not specifically going to look at those attributes right now, but the master page, the site.master page, is exactly what you might think it is by a master page. It is a master set of code that you can inherit HTML from. So let's look at the architecture of how you would inherit everything in this master page in these other pages. So the architecture so far is that we have a default that has a master page file, meaning that it's going to inherit properties from a master page file, and the master page file is right here, site.master. So things that you would normally see in an HTML file, like the doc type, the HTML, and the head, those do all exist right here in the master page, meaning that you don't have to repeat those every time you create a new ASPX page. It has a number of other things, some we're going to look at right now. Like if we go over here, we see that we have something called a script manager with a number of scripts. Well, we're going to talk about script managers in details as we move through the classes, but scripts are exactly what you might think they are. Scripts are, in this case, we're going to look at some scripts which are JavaScripts. Okay, JavaScripts that you're specifically going to use in your pages. Now, you can embed the JavaScript directly in the page like you might be used to doing if you've done JavaScript programming, but as you know, you can also have scripts that are contained in external files. In this case, the JavaScripts underneath this scripts are going to be like webforms.js that you see right here, or treeview.js, scripts that you can use within that specific page. And notice that they're embedded within a script manager, within a set of scripts tags, and it looks like a collection of script references, essentially saying where those scripts exist. Okay, so we have access to all those scripts, and the beauty of this is you're going to have access to all the scripts that you put in the site.master in each of the pages that you create that inherit from the site.master. Now, if you're going to use site.master, there's a few things that you're going to want to know how to do, and I'm going to go into two of them in particular. Okay, one of the things that we want to look at is this concept here of a content placeholder, because essentially what you need to do is you want to put content into the page that you'd put in from the other pages, like the other pages that you create that inherit from site.master. So these content placeholders actually are places where you're going to hold information. They have an ID, and in the case of this specific project, the IDs are featured context and featured content and main content. So two content placeholders with two pieces, two IDs, featured content, main content. Okay, now I'm going to now go back over to default.aspx, and we're going to look at, and I'm going to slide this over so you can get a little bit more code that you can see. And what you'll see is that here's a content tag. Okay, if you think of the concept of a content placeholder, now I'm going to create content. And this content also has an ID, but what it importantly has is a content placeholder ID. This featured content. Featured content must match with what you have in the site master. Essentially saying, here's a placeholder where we're going to put stuff. Here is the stuff that we're going to put there. So you have a start tag, you have an end tag, and everything that is within these tags is going to go right over here within this specific location of the content placeholder. All right, so let's go back over. I'm going to show you, if you look at this, you'll see that you have a section and a div tag. Those are good tags to be able to organize materials and format materials, which you're going to do. But if we look back over, that actually refers to this blue section right here. That is my content piece that's right there. Now, we're going to look at some of the things that you can do here. You might not be familiar with the H group, which is a tag for a header group. And if you look at it, you have a header-based header one and a header two, so it's a header group. And you'll see this right here. I can embed code directly in my basically ASPX file, which is the file that contains the HTML. But ASPX has information that is processed at the server and served to the client already in a formatted in a format. So one of the things I have here is this less than percent. The less than percent is an opening and a closing tag where I'm going to actually put ASPX code. The colon is just a shortcut, essentially says print, and we're going to print title. Okay, well, right now you can see if I look at where this actually is, title, and then modify this template to jumpstart your ASP.NET application, you'll see that you see homepage, period, modify this template to jumpstart your ASP.NET application. Well, where did that all come from? Homepage didn't say title there. Well, if we go back up to the directive, you see the page directive has an attribute called title, which is also a property of the page, and there it is. Now, what I could do here is title is actually also a shortcut. I could have said page dot, and if I scroll down through this, I'd see that there's a property title, okay, but I've already got that property title right there, and if I rerun this again, okay, it's going to give me essentially exactly the same thing. So you see, home page, that would be the title that was pulled from the page directive sitting right there. Okay, well, that's just all great and dandy. You can do some pretty nice things with that. Let's go ahead and stop this and let's do something just to demonstrate what you've got the capability of doing here. I'm going to take this colon out because I don't want to print something right now. I'm actually going to do something. I'm going to do something called new title. Okay, this is actually looks just like code would be on the C# side. Page.title equals new title. Okay, now, what happens if I run this now? Well, right now, if you do this, it's going to make the page title a new title, but you're not going to be able to see it. So I'm going to go ahead and put a second one in here, put the colon, and now I'm going to print the page title, or output the page title to the page, again like I did, but I notice I changed the title. Okay, so what will happen now? Well, if I go ahead and run this, and I bring it over, you're going to see that new title. Okay, I changed the title in that first one and now I've got it in my second one. So you can see that. And then the rest of the part with the modify this template to jumpstart your ASP.NET application. So let's go ahead and stop the running of the code here. And let's just move a little bit through some of the other parts that we've looked at here. ASP content, that was that wrapper of the content that you had that you actually defined in the site master. And then you have another content, which is that second content placeholder. And if you notice what's inside of here, it's all just standard HTML tags. List items, references, headers, okay, ordered list, furious HTML, that's good old plain old HTML with some links in there. So all relatively straightforward stuff. Okay, now one last thing I'm going to go through here is, and we're going to do this as we move along, we're going to work with this project and learn more and more about this project. But if you look over here at your Solution Explorer, this is your Solution Explorer. And within your Solution Explorer, you've got one project. That project is also has the same name as the solution. The project is Sample Application COP 4834. The beauty of solutions is they can contain multiple projects. Okay, in this case, it contains one project. And then everything else is very well organized. By default, you have these things called, you have for properties, references, account, app data, app start, content, images, scripts. Then you have some specific codes about, bundle, contact, default. Now, contact isn't in every single one. Default was the default page. You have a global, okay, and you have the site master. And then most important one that you're going to see, which we're going to work with a lot, is this web.config, because web.config has a lot of information that is very important to how your application runs. And we're going to be making changes to the web.config. So what I've done is I've just taken a fire hose and sprayed a tremendous amount of information at you. And we're going to have a lot more information because the first thing we're going to do is we're going to analyze just this default application so that you understand everything that goes on the default application. One last thing, because I did promise you that I'd take two things from the site master that you'd have here. The other one being, see these scripts, script.reference, or script references that you have here. Okay, those script references, see the path? The path of those script references is scripts, web forms, webforms.js. Okay, that refers to a specific location where there is a JavaScript. If you come over to your project, you come over to scripts, which is right here, You look within web forms and you will see there are those JavaScripts that go specifically with the JavaScript that's over here. Now, you're going to be writing some JavaScript, but at the same time, there's a tremendous amount of JavaScript that's going to be available to you, and we're going to use a tremendous number of JavaScript tools, because by the time this class is over, you're going to be able to write rich web applications that can do tremendous amounts of that can process and work with tremendous amounts of information, and you're going to be able to make these applications do what you want them to do. So, very fast, quick run through. Something that you're going to want to do yourself is make this specific application, okay, using the default, and start running through it and making modifications to it. Don't worry if you break it, okay? Okay, what I do want you to do after every time that you work with something or doing a new project, I want you to make a backup of exactly where you are, because you're going to break stuff as you move forward, and you're always going to want to be able to go back to the previous assignment and start from scratch again. So always make sure that you do that, okay? Hopefully you'll enjoy this, good programming, and you will enjoy, if you're in the COP 4834 that I'm making this for, you're going to have a great time with this class. Thank you very much.